Okay. Good morning, good afternoon, and greetings from Europe, and more specifically from France, which is my country. First, I would like to thank Cineo for giving me the opportunity to participate to this webinar. I feel very honored. Thank you very much. Now, let me briefly introduce myself. As teacher and as in charge of international relations and projects in education, I've been involved in international mobility and mobility program for long now. To my mind, mobility is an important element of an individual's lifelong learning journey and should be recognized as such. I've always been interested in the development of mechanisms and tools that facilitate the recognition and transfer of all aspects of the mobility experience. I currently contribute to studies and brainstorming sessions on the issue with CDFOP, the European Commission, and other French and European organizations. I also participated in the EU-ASEAN Share Project as CTS and Mobility Core Expert for Campus France from 2015 to 2019. Today, I will represent the European Association for Institutions in Professional Higher Education, EURACHE. EURACHE is one of the main stakeholders in the European higher education area. For more information about EURACHE, feel free to consult its website. You have the link at the end of the PowerPoint presentation. Before starting my PowerPoint presentation, I would like to say that there are currently no real exhaustive data on the impact of COVID-19 in learning mobility in Europe. There's been some studies conducted so far, but we are still in the course of the crisis, which makes it difficult to draw any substantial conclusion. I have yet collected some data and figures to show you from some studies and surveys already carried out. They will set a bit the present context of higher education and student mobility in Europe. Then I will give you some concrete feedback from my sharing with colleagues about what it has been like in different European countries so far. So let's see the first slide. It's about the closure of higher education institutions in Europe. As you can see, this is a map of the European countries participating to the Erasmus Plus program. Erasmus Plus is the European flagship mobility and partnership program funded by the European Commission, and that is widely successful among students and institutions. There are different colors on the map that correspond to the closing and expected dates of reopening of the institutions in Europe. So let's focus on the reopening. As you can see, at the moment, there are countries that have already reopened their higher education institutions and others that are on the point to do so. This doesn't mean that institutions will be fully open, but students may, for example, get access to library and laboratories, provided they comply with the safety and health standards linked to COVID-19, of course. This also may correspond to periods of assessments and exams that could still be on. Countries that are in orange are countries that have not confirmed the reopening dates yet. France, for example, has finally decided that higher education institutions will reopen later in September. It doesn't mean that nobody is working. On the contrary, staff and academics have to be very inventive to continue their study program from a distance and to avoid disruption in students' curriculum. What I also would like to add is that many borders close approximately on the at the same date as higher education institutions closed on the 16th March 2020, with consequences on air and train transport. This made it complicated for mobile students to go back home. The second slide, showing a chart, is taken from a survey conducted by Erasmus Students Network. The survey was carried out in March, from the 19th to 30th March 2020, quite at the beginning of lockdown in Europe. And the figures that are given on the chart may have changed now. It's probably higher for the return home and less for the same destination. The motivation of staying or leaving may also depend on the host country's decision in reference to the previous slide. Among the respondents to the survey, 65 students reported that their mobility continued. The report says courses provision was mainly done remotely and with online learning tools, and among the remaining 25% of the students, some had their mobility temporarily cancelled and or postponed. The majority of students also indicated that information provision was in place and quite complete, which is important, particularly for foreign students that could feel even more anxious and stressed by such a situation far from home and family. Two recommendations by EFN after online courses have been noted. One concerns access to online learning tools that should be equal to all and take the diversity of students' population into account. This may highlight the limits of the all online solution, as for example, the lack of IT equipment for some mobile students used to doing their homework at the campus library, and the internet access, sometimes restricted for those returned home. The second is about the implementation of actions and interactions between students that should be encouraged in online learning activities. This wish might be due to the frustrations strongly felt by confined mobile students. An important part of the mobility experience is inter-human relations and a different cultural approach. How to cope with human and intercultural reality online if there is no interaction? So, what has happened so far as to students' mobility for studies? So courses and support are generally provided online. For mobile students and for a continuum in their study plan for mobility, support is normally provided by the host institution in compliance with what had been agreed in the learning agreement. This includes assessment and validation by the host. But given to the specificity of the parent situation, arrangements have between host and home institutions are possible and can be considered on case-by-case basis. It also depends on the term of their inter-institutional partnership agreement. Although the case of global pandemic may not have been stated there so far, the main challenge is to make possible and to make the utmost and help students reach the mobility expected or intended learning outcomes and have these learning outcomes assessed and validated. Things are certainly made easier for students in the European higher education area thanks to our common credit system, ECTS, that enables a good understanding and trust between partner schools and universities. And this is also consolidated by the Erasmus, or thanks to the common mobility processes and documents set by the Erasmus Plus program, and commonly used also for non-Erasmus Plus mobile students in Europe. So, what is it for students' mobility for in-company internship, traineeship, or work experience? The issue is more complex. It's then up to the home institution together with the host company to solve the problem. Some host companies accepted to give remote activities to trainees, turning the physical experience into teleworking. If a student was already in the company when pandemic was declared, decision had to be made by the home institution and in compliance with their national rules and regulations or recommendations. Up to the home institution, then, to manage pedagogical and validation issues and other financial, for example. Liaison with the host company is also very important there. And as for students' mobility for studies, the learning agreement is also an important part of the process here. The learning agreement for traineeship is agreed by the three parties, the home institution, the host company, and students. It's also an important piece to identify which expected learning outcomes have already been acquired during the period already carried out, and which ones remains to be achieved. The learning agreement also enables the partners to deal with the issue of assessment, validation, recognition of the experience. If a student was due to leave soon for mobility at the moment of lockdown, then postponing the experience may be considered, otherwise it may be cancelled. As to teacher and staff mobility now, it's a bit the same. I guess most of mobile participants already at the host country came back home. Depending on the host institution and country and of the decision made by the home institution, some may have decided to stay. But the recommendations by authorities in the country of origin prevail. In the event the mobility has not started yet, then it may be postponed or cancelled to be considered by the different parties again. In the same way, as for the students, the parties are bound to a mobility agreement signed by the three parties as well, and with details of the expected experience, outcomes, and other terms that has to be signed and prepared before the mobility starts. In any case, it all implies a good connection and communication between international relation offices and academics at home and host institutions. If this has not been set up from the very beginning of the mobility partnership, the current situation would be more than impossible to handle for the different stakeholders or actors, and more specifically for students. As my conclusion, I would say that impact on mobility due to COVID-19 pandemic could probably be measured and lessons to be learned taken into account in the future. Risk management, including in the event of a pandemic, is certainly a section to be detailed in a formal document as a partnership agreement for mobility. Lots of partnership agreements include risk management, but the event of pandemic should be in the list. of the risks that may happen during mobility. Future mobility format could be a mixture of physical and virtual experience. Let's wait and see what will happen. New sharing. I have included here some documentation here that you may be interested to have a look at. It's all about credit transfer, mobility, organization of mobility, and mobility documents that have been inspired from Erasmus Plus and the European Credit Transfer System and adapted to the ASEAN context. Okay, for now then, hope I was not too quick in my explanation. Thank you for your attention and take care. May you need any further comments on or information, please do not hesitate to contact me, either via Eurashi's website or by Simeo Secretariat. Goodbye.